Welcome to the fifth lecture in our series on the endocrine system. Today, we will be looking at disorders of antidiuretic hormone. For a review of antidiuretic hormone physiology, please see earlier lectures in this series. A link is provided in the show notes. The two hormones made in the hypothalamus and stored in the posterior pituitary are antidiuretic hormone, ADH, arginine vasopressin or simply vasopressin, and oxytocin. Today, we will look at disorders of antidiuretic hormone. Understanding what happens when there's a disorder of an endocrine gland, too much or too little hormone being produced, can be very helpful in cementing your understanding of how the normal gland functions. Today, we'll look at the problem of insufficient vasopressin, called central diabetes insipidus, and we'll also look at excessive antidiuretic hormone secretion, syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone, or simply SIADH. Let's start by looking at insufficient antidiuretic hormone release. This is called diabetes insipidus. Don't let the word diabetes confuse you. We're not talking about diabetes mellitus, a problem with blood glucose. Diabetes refers to excessive urination or polyuria. Today, we're looking at a problem with ADH secretion from the hypothalamic pituitary axis, another kind of diabetes insipidus due to the kidney not being able to respond to antidiuretic hormone is called nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Since ADH is made in the hypothalamus and carried to the posterior pituitary along nerve tracts, anything that disrupts either its formation or its movement to the posterior pituitary can be a cause of central diabetes insipidus. These causes can include things like trauma, infection, vascular disease, blood clots, for example, or congenital absence of antidiuretic hormone formation, among other things. The onset of central diabetes insipidus can be slow or abrupt. As you can imagine from the list of possible causes, it can occur at any age. If you're familiar with the effects of antidiuretic hormone, you should be able to figure out at least one of the primary symptoms. What would happen if you had no ADH effect? Pause the video and see if you can work this out. Remember that antidiuretic hormone causes the kidney to retain water and to secrete a concentrated urine. Without antidiuretic hormone, the kidney can't concentrate the urine and therefore excretes large quantities of a dilute urine. This is called polyuria. Now notice, this is not the same as urinary frequency, which would be frequent urination in small amounts. You'll often see this in the presence of a urinary tract infection. So when you speak to your patients, be careful of how you ask a question. Because the patient is losing large amounts of water in the urine, excessive thirst and excessive drinking compensate. We call this excessive drinking polydipsia. Normally, urine output is approximately a liter or a liter and a half in a day. With central diabetes insipidus, the patient loses 3 liters or more of urine in a day. Sometimes as many as 25 or 30 liters in a 24-hour period. So the symptoms of polyuria and polydipsia are quite obvious, but there's more. For example, the patient will wake up at night to urinate. This is called nocturia. And of course, the loss of a lot of fluid from the body can cause dehydration and even low blood volume. To make the diagnosis, you simply deny your patient water and then test the concentration of the urine, see what happens. If the body's holding on to water, the water gets pulled out of the urine, increasing the osmolarity, making it saltier. Look at this beaker of salt water. If you remove water from it, or you just let the water evaporate, what's left is more salty, higher osmolarity. So after ADH has signaled the kidney to pull out water, the urine that's left should be highly concentrated. In patients with central diabetes insipidus, they don't have enough ADH to signal the kidney to reclaim water, so the urine amount is high and the urine is dilute and high in volume. Sometimes the ADH level is normal, but the kidneys don't respond to it. This is called nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. To test this, at the end of the study, you give your patient a dose of desmopressin, which is a drug that acts like vasopressin. If the problem is insufficient vasopressin, then the urine should become concentrated. If the problem is that the kidney can't respond to vasopressin, then giving your patient vasopressin should have no effect, and the patient will continue to excrete large amounts of dilute urine. This test is not without its dangers. See the links for details. Here's a comment from one of the links on setting up for the water deprivation test. The treatment of central diabetes insipidus is replacing antidiuretic hormone. Desmopressin is a synthetic variety of ADH that can be injected, taken orally, or taken as a nasal medication. Let's move on to excessive antidiuretic hormone secretion. Here we see Polly Jones getting her pre-op labs done for a routine hysterectomy. After surgery, she had a very slow return of bowel function and was unable to eat or drink. She was maintained on IV fluid only. Unfortunately, her IVs contained glucose, but not enough sodium. Ms. Jones suffered from an unusual complication of surgery, SIADH, or the syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. The hypothalamus was synthesizing and releasing vasopressin in excessive amounts. What effect did this have on her body osmolarity and her sodium ion concentration? If you've been paying attention to antidiuretic hormone effects, you should be able to figure out what too much antidiuretic hormone will do. Back to the beaker. Antidiuretic hormone causes the body to retain water. So what you're doing now is you're adding more and more water to the beaker. This makes the contents less and less salty. This is exactly what happens in the human body with excessive ADH secretion. Hyponatremia, too low sodium concentration. Things did not end well for Miss Jones. Her sodium level dropped so low that she suffered a seizure, vomited, aspirated or inhaled the vomitus, and developed severe respiratory problems. She was admitted to the intensive care unit and died there 3 days later. The treatment for SIADH is simply to give the patient sodium solution in her IV. In Ms. Jones' case, maintaining her with extra sodium in her IV would have kept her safe until her body recovered from the inappropriate secretion of vasopressin. In other patients, correcting the underlying cause can be more difficult. Please see the references in the show notes for further information. This completes our rather brief treatment of vasopressin disorders. Thank you for your attention. Here are the photo credits for our presentation. And here's some information on the Creative Commons license information, both for the photos and for this presentation. Once again, thank you for your attention.